great, amazing teaching of dinosaurs and dragons. Let's open up to Job chapter 40 and 41. As we journey through the Bible, chapter by chapter, verse by verse, we left off with verse 6. Job 40, verse 6. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, "Now prepare yourself like a man, and I will question you, and you shall answer me. Would you indeed annul my judgments, and would you condemn me that you may be justified? Have you an arm like God, or can you thunder a voice like his? Well, if that's the case, then adorn yourself with majesty and splendor and array yourself with glory and beauty and disperse the rage of your wrath and look on everyone who is proud and humble and humble him. Look on everyone who is proud and bring him low. Tread down on the wicked of their place and hide them in the dust together. Bind their faces in the hidden darkness. And then I will also confess to you that your own right hand can save you." Let's pray. Lord, thank you again for our day. We ask, Lord, that you'd bless those who are sick at home, and Lord, that you would just touch their bodies, a lot of cold and flu going around. And so, Lord, that you just bless our time now through your word in Jesus' name. Amen. So at this point, again, from the last 2 weeks, God has shown his universe, his creation to Job. Job, where were you? Last week, we saw the animal kingdom, wonderful. And then what God does here is he's going to end with two amazing animals that he created. And we need to remember that. And we're going to do something different today, but we're going to read this section and then we'll come back. Amen. So that first section is Job, or God just responding back to Job, because Job had said, "Listen, I am vile. I have nothing really to say. What can I say to you? How can I proceed any further?" And, without Job really repenting at that moment, God goes into another section, and then he will bring these two amazing animals out. Amen? So let's pick it up. In verse 15, he says, "Now look at the behemoth, which I made," please note that, "I made along with you. He eats grass like an ox. See now his strength that is in his hips, and his power is in his stomach muscles. He moves his tail like a cedar, and his sinews of his thighs are tightly knit. His bones are like the beams of bronze, and his ribs are like the bars of iron. He is the first of the way of God." And by the way, that means the chief of. That means there's nothing greater that God created as an animal than behemoth. Does everybody got that? That's important. So he is the chief of all of God's ways. "Only he who made him can bring him near to a sword. Surely the mountains yield food for him, and the beast of the fields play there. And he lies under the lotus trees in a covert and reeds and marsh. The lotus trees cover him with their shade, and the willows by the brook surround him. And indeed, the river may rage, yet he is not disturbed." That means a torrent of water is not going to move this animal. "He is confident, though the Jordan gushes into his mouth," so he could drink a ton, "and though he may take it in his eyes or one pierce his nose with a snare." And then we get into Leviathan, chapter 41. Can you draw out Leviathan with a hook, or snare his tongue with a line which you lower? Can you put a reed through his nose or pierce his jaw with a hook? Will he make supplications to you, or will he speak softly to you? Will he make a covenant with you, and will you take him as a servant forever? Will you play with him as with a bird, or will you leash him for your maidens? Will your companions make a banquet of him, and will they apportion him among the merchants? Can you fill his skin with harpoons, or his head with fishing spears? Now lay your hand on him, remember the battle, and never do it again. The idea is if you're playing with this animal, you're never going to forget it. Indeed, any hope of overcoming him is false. Shall one not be overwhelmed at the sight of him or terrified at him? No one is so fierce that he would dare stir him. Who then is able to stand against me? Who has preceded me that I should pay him? Everything under heaven is mine, and I will not conceal his limbs and his mighty power and his gracious portions. Now, who can remove his outer coat? And who can approach him with a double bridle? Who can open up the doors of his face with his terrible teeth all around? His rows of scales are his pride, shut up tightly with a seal. One is so near one another so that no air can even come between them. They are joined one to another, and they stick together, and they cannot be parted. Listen to this. His sneezings flash forth light, and his eyes are like the eyelids of the morning. And out of his mouth go burning lights. Sparks of fire shoot out. Smoke goes out of his nostrils, and as from a boiling pot and burning rushes. His breath kindles coals, and a flame goes out of his mouth. Now, I don't want to get into it here, but I mean, is God joking? He created this. So we're going to unpack this all today. And this is the real problem that I have in the church today. No one really reads their Bible. Or they go, hey, that cross thing, that was real, but this isn't real. What are you talking about? Do you see the problem that we have in the church? So let's keep going. He says, strength dwells in his neck, and sorrow dances before him. The folds of his flesh are joined together, and they are firm on him and cannot be moved. His heart is like a heart of stone, even as hard as the lower millstone. And when he raises himself up, the mighty are afraid. Because of his crashing, they are beside themselves. Though the sword reaches him, it cannot avail, nor does a spear, dart, or javelin. And he regards iron as straw and bronze as rotten wood. And the arrows cannot make him flee. Sling stones become like stubble to him. Darts are regarded as straw. He laughs at the threat of javelins. His undersides are like sharp potsherds. He spreads pointed marks in the mire. And he makes the deep boil like a pot. And he makes the sea like a point of ointment. And he leaves a shining wake behind him. One would think that the deep had white hair. On the earth, there is nothing like him, which is made without fear. And he beholds every high thing. He is the king over the children of pride. Now, I want to start out coming back to chapter 40, verse 15, speaking of Behemoth. And I need to start everybody with this premise, or nothing is going to make sense from this point. Amen? Here we go. If you start with the premise of Darwinian evolution and the mixing of the Bible, does everybody get what I'm saying is? Because in the church today, they are teaching both, that both can cohabitate together. That is complete nonsense. And if you do a study, and I don't want to get into this study today, but when the communists wanted to destroy the United States of America, they said, as Khrushchev said, his famous line that we will not destroy you from without, we will destroy you from within. And what they did is they sent infiltrators into the universities. I know that's shocking, isn't it? Or you can say it's not so. But you know where else they sent them? Into the seminaries. Because they realized that what we would, evangelical Christians were so easily believing the stuff of Marxism and communism because they really had not been taught properly. And so as they infiltrated this, what do you think they brought with them? They brought Darwinian evolution with them. And so a lot of that is inside of the church today. And listen, just have fun. Talk to somebody you know in a church somewhere else or a family member that goes to church and ask them, do they believe in a literal six-day creation? Do they believe in dinosaurs? Do they believe in dragons? And see what their response is. Because, guys, if you believe Genesis 1:1, I have no problem believing that God told us that this is what happened. Why is it such a stretch? It's a stretch because for the last 100 years, we have been slowly beat down with the idea that, again, Christians believing in science and dinosaurs, you're crackpots. It's 200 million years old. It's 600 million years old. It's 1 billion years old. There's no way that man lived with dinosaurs. Do you see the point? And then we read this and we go, it's probably not a dinosaur. It's a hippopotamus. Are you kidding me? Hippopotamus have the smallest tail. They don't have a tail like a cedar. But we're forced into thinking that we're kooky. Because science, they're so brilliant. Do you see what's frustrating inside of the modern day church? And so what we need to do is we push back on that and we say, which we'll get to the end, is we believe in a six-day creation and we believe that God said exactly what he said, which is I made the behemoth and the Leviathan. But our problem is we come at the Bible oftentimes with these preconceived ideas, and the modern preconceived ideas is that dinosaurs are 600 million years old. And so we read this and we go, well, it can't be. These two animals described here are dinosaurs, which occupied the same time as man did. And I mentioned this before, but let me say it here. The word dinosaur is a new invention. It was only invented in 1841. Take note of that. Before then, they were known as dragons. They weren't known as dinosaurs. So we have a new invention. And the other thing I want to say here is, and I have this on my list, and we'll talk about this at the end, but, you know, you go to a museum and you see a dinosaur bone, right, and they put it together, and right next to it, what do they have there? They have a nice little picture of that. How do they know that's what it looked like? You're going off of some creative artist who goes, yeah, I think that looks great. How do you know that? That is the point. We don't know that. And in fact, the more study we do have of dinosaurs or dragons, the more we realize we have no idea what goes on in them and what their bones were made of and all of that. So we have these guesses, but we really don't know. And so verse 15 says, look now at behemoth, which I made with you. So just like before, when Job was given the examples of the animals, God is telling him, Job, look, you've seen this animal. You've seen the lion. You've seen the eagle. You've seen all of this. And so for God to change his mind and go, hey, I'm just talking about a mythical creature, really doesn't line up. Do you see that? And that's called context. And so we're going to do something I have never done before here. Rather than me tell you, I'm going to show you what these animals look like from a creationist point of view, from a biblical scientist point of view. Amen? And then I'll come up and we'll end and we'll wrap it all together because I've got some great questions. So let's roll that.
Many people have asked, where do dinosaurs fit into the biblical timeline? And what does the Bible say about dinosaurs? Yes, the Bible does mention dinosaurs, even specifically. But before we get there, let's take a quick look at the big picture. Evolution holds that dinosaurs evolved 220 million years ago and died about 65 million years ago from any of a number of possible extinction events. But the Bible teaches that all land animals, including dinosaurs, were created on the sixth day of creation, just thousands of years ago, and they were all named by Adam just before God handed over his completed creation to Adam and Eve, charging them to take dominion over his completed creation. Then, about 4,400 years ago, the entire world was deluged by Noah's flood, and the dinosaurs, along with billions of other creatures, were wiped out. Let's take a quick look at some evidences that show that the biblical account might actually be true. First, dinosaurs are cleverly designed. Consider this Triceratops. Its 2,000-pound head is mounted in a way that allows it to turn every which way, yet still be strong enough to ram something, even while running. What about massive sauropods with weight-bearing systems from hip to toe that allow its 200,000-pound body to even walk, and neck vertebrae that are 90% filled with air so it can lift up its head? Next, there's the absence of dinosaur ancestors and transitions. Even the Chicago Field Museum sign admits there have been zero transitions between dinosaur kinds. It shows question marks regarding where they came from. It's almost like someone just put each basic kind on Earth right at the same time. There are even dinosaur design features that show they lived in the ideal pre-flood world. Pterodactyls may have been too heavy to fly in today's atmosphere. Same with huge pre-flood dragonflies. The fossil record is filled with giant creatures and plants. We know this because there are billions of dead things buried in rock layers laid down by water all over the Earth. And when we look at the dinosaur fossil record, we see that they were buried furiously, rapidly, and simultaneously, oftentimes found fleeing in groups. Take this massive bone bed in Hilda, Canada. Thousands of centrosaurs were catastrophically buried over an entire square mile. Or this one in China, where thousands of different kinds of dinosaurs were simultaneously buried in a single 980-foot-long ravine. There are hundreds of dinosaur bone beds all over the world, including the U.S., where the Morrison Formation covers 13 states and 700,000 square miles. Thousands of torn-apart dinosaurs are buried here in hundreds of mass graves, with many found in the classic death pose with their necks arched back, choking as they died. Museum signs everywhere even admit they died in a watery catastrophe. Some dinosaurs are even found mummified, with tree leaves, flowers, ferns, shrubs, and algae still in their stomach. Dinosaurs are even found buried with marine creatures. Isn't a global flood the best explanation for this? Scientists have been discovering soft tissue in dinosaur bones. They describe blood cells, blood vessels, connective tissue, and even collagen, which has a maximum shelf life of about 900,000 years at 40 degrees. With a maximum shelf life of less than 1 million years, what's collagen doing in dinosaur bones that are supposedly 65 million years old? Many dinosaur bones are even found unfossilized in places like Madagascar, Alaska, and Montana. Does this evidence seem to support the Bible's recent and violent flood, or evolution stories? But some would say, if the Bible includes the truth about Earth history, it would specifically mention dinosaurs. Well, the term dinosaur wasn't even invented until 1841, and Bible translations before this time used the term dragon over 35 times, in many contexts describing dinosaur-like creatures. Job chapter 40 describes a majestic creature using the name Behemoth, which means colossal beast. In context, Job and his philosopher friends just finished over 30 chapters of dialogue trying to explain God and why he would allow such hardships into Job's life. Then God shows up in a whirlwind, tells Job to brace himself like a man, and says that he would be the one asking Job the questions for a while. Then, for four chapters straight, God asks Job 77 rhetorical questions that all have to do with creation. After explaining to Job that he is the master designer of space and earth, God describes 13 of his created animals, such as an ostrich, horse, and deer, then caps off the discussion by telling Job about his two grandest creations, Behemoth and Leviathan. God calls Behemoth the first of all his ways, meaning the first in rank, the chief, the most supreme of his creative works. In context, God is saying to Job, "Sit down, brace yourself, and now I will tell you of the chief of all my works, the biggest, most amazing land creature I ever made." When we scan through all land-dwelling creatures, both living and extinct, which one comes up as the first in rank, the most colossal, or the chief? Clearly the sauropod dinosaur. Pairing God's word that Behemoth is the grandest creature he ever made with the fact that sauropods are the largest land creatures we've ever found should give us a clue to Behemoth's identity. Sauropods were huge. The largest one found to date was over 120 feet long. That's 10 freeway lanes across. At a weight of 76 tons, it's a wonder these creatures could even walk. In fact, Dr. Waddell was granted an international award for discovering one of the secrets behind how their mobility was even possible. Their bones were pneumatic. They were charged with air. Dr. Waddell notes they were marvels of biological engineering, and that efficiency of design is especially evident in their vertebrae, the bones that make up the backbone. It turns out their vertebrae was increasingly lighter, higher up the spinal column, and were filled with air, some up to 90%.
When Matt puts sauropod backbones through a CT scanner, he finds a real surprise. The X-ray slices from the CT scans revealed not marrow, but a honeycomb pattern inside the dinosaur's back and neck bones, filled only with air. Matt's work shows that the bigger dinosaurs got, the more air they had in their vertebrae.
This is one neck vertebra from Supersaurus.
A neck bone like this would have been light enough for one man to lift. The same size mammal bone would require a forklift.
Now, we found that the biggest of these sauropods, the vertebrae were about 90% air. So that's comparable to styrofoam.
So the bigger the dinosaurs got, the more air sac-like structures running into the bone.
Absolutely.
While this may solve the puzzle of how they could lift and move their massive heads and necks, it doesn't solve the challenge of how they could possibly inhale enough oxygen through their tiny nostrils, which were only about twice the size of those on a living horse. Perhaps they thrived better in a world before Noah's flood when the oxygen levels were likely higher. Their long necks and tails resembled living suspension bridges. For this creature to eat, breathe, and move its long neck, the series of over 12 neck vertebrae had to be interlocking and twistable. They also had to have anchoring points in just the right places for muscles and ligaments to connect in such a way to prevent the neck from pinching veins and nerves and to brace the trachea and esophagus. God even describes behemoth's diet, eating grass like an ox. In 2005, researchers found grass and sauropod coprolites in India, and some paleobotanists are even saying that this will cause a rewrite in our understanding of dinosaur evolution, because evolution holds that grass didn't evolve until millions of years after the dinosaurs had gone extinct. God describes behemoth strength in his hips and power in his stomach muscles. Again, we have a strong clue that behemoth was a sauropod dinosaur because, while many animals have strong hips and stomach muscles, none were as strong as the sauropod. The muscle structure around the hips and stomach that were necessary for sauropods to move, walk, turn, and eat would be incredible. In fact, for some sauropods, like the Diplodocus, its highest point of its core body was the hips, and its whole body balanced on the hips, front to back. Diplodocus was able to rear up on its back legs and balance on its tail like a tripod, making use of the hips to support not just the back half of its body, but the front half too. This required enormous strength in the hip and stomach muscles, considering they lifted tons of its own body into the air. Below the hips was an incredible weight distribution system that went from a massive femur, which in some cases was about 8 feet long, to 2 shin bones, then to 5 toes. Behemoth's tail also closely matches those of sauropods. God describes that he moves his tail like a cedar tree, and follows this by stating the sinews of his thighs are tightly knit. Paleontologists have learned from muscle attachment locations in their bones that the tightly knit structure of behemoth's thighs and hips actually made his tail sway from side to side with each step, much as a cedar tree does when it sways in the wind. Tail drag marks are only rarely found behind sauropod footprints, indicating their tails were raised while they walked. It's difficult to think of a creature that fits this biblical description better than a sauropod dinosaur. God describes his bones like beams of bronze. Most Bible versions translate this phrase as tubes of bronze, conduits of bronze, or pipes of brass, which conveys both strength and being hollow like a channel or a tube. This matches the fact that sauropods had the largest leg bones of any animal, and they are in fact just like tubes of metal, having a hard outer casing and spongy marrow and veins on the inside. Then God says that its ribs are like bars of iron. Unlike much of sauropod's skeleton that was spongy and filled with air for weight savings, its ribs were fully ossified. They were made out of solid bone. Again, we have a perfect match. God even describes behemoth's habitat. He lies under the lotus trees, in a covert of reeds and marsh. The lotus trees cover him with their shade, and the willows by the brook surround him. This was a creature that had to be near lots of green food, living in a lush, tropical environment. Large sauropods had to eat half a ton of vegetation every day, and they likely had to eat all day long to consume this amount of food. Next, God says that, indeed, the river may rage, yet he is not disturbed. He is confident, though the Jordan gushes into his mouth. Why would God point out that this animal can stand in a rushing river? Lots of animals can do this, depending on the size of the rushing river. In this case, God said the river may rage, yet he is not disturbed, in that behemoth is confident even though this raging river should gush into his mouth. The Jordan River is the largest river in Palestine, and it currently flows at only 15% of the rate it flowed in the past. Even so, in the winter, this river would be incredibly difficult to cross, and it would take a very sizable animal to stand undisturbed in this rushing current, and even more, let the current gush into its mouth. Some of the larger sauropods stood over 20 feet at the shoulders and weighed over 70 tons. Creatures of this size and mass could withstand a raging river better than any others. Even with all this evidence, some say that Behemoth was just a mythical creature. But why would God try to display his awesome creative power by describing something that never existed? Anyone can do that. And why would God say that Behemoth was the chief of all his creations after describing 13 real, still-living animals in the same passage? Why go through all the trouble to describe Behemoth as a grass-eating animal that lies peacefully in the shadow of the river plants along with his physical description, diet, and habitat, all of which happen to fit a known creature, a sauropod dinosaur? Certain Bible footnotes state that Behemoth was a hippo or an elephant, but neither comes close to matching all 13 characteristics God used to describe Behemoth. Certainly hippos and elephants aren't the first in rank or chief of God's creations. Would God tell Job to gird up his loins, to behold the chief of his creations, just to show off a hippo? An elephant? These creatures were plentiful. They also don't have tails that sway like cedar trees, and both of these animals have been captured and killed by man throughout history. But God says that only Behemoth's creator can approach him, that he cannot be captured by humans when he is on watch, and that no one can use barbs to pierce his nose. These impossibilities fit sauropod dinosaurs better than any other animals because of their towering heads and huge size. With a head that reached over 40 feet high, it could also see people coming from far away. Its massive tail also makes him unapproachable. Based on what we know from fossils, some sauropods could cover a 200-foot circle with deadly force using their tails, which could be over 50 feet long and weigh over 13,000 pounds. Recent studies have shown that some sauropods could probably create sonic booms with their tails, just like a whip. It's not by chance that God says to Job that Behemoth can only be approached by his creator. Good luck even getting near this creature to put a snare in its nose. To this day, elephants and hippos are surrounded by hunters and killed, but sauropods better fit this passage because they are simply unapproachable. God says that he made Behemoth, along with man, like during the same creation week, not millions of years ago. God made Adam as the last of his creations and gave him dominion over all the animals that had just been created during creation week, not just some of the creatures. Why else would God tell Job to consider or behold a creature which no human had ever seen? Just in the last 20 years, over 50 articles have been published in scientific journals that have documented 14 bioorganic materials in dinosaur bones that simply cannot be millions of years old. These include blood vessels, red blood cells, hemoglobin, bone cells, ovalbumin, chitin, unmineralized bone, collagen, limited DNA, skin pigments, FEX proteins, histones, keratin, and elastin. Just 20 years ago, most scientists simply assumed dinosaur bones were solid mineralized impressions of bones, but modern science has now revealed that many of the dinosaur bones are original, even at the molecular level.
Hello, I'm Neil deGrasse Tyson, your host for Nova Science Now.
For the last decade, the African island has offered Ray and Christy Rogers a spectacular excavation site. They work in an area of remote grasslands where dinosaur bones literally cover the ground, an ancient graveyard where an unusually large number of dinosaurs died and were entombed by mud flows that preserve their bones.
The preservation is unbelievable. The quality of the material is exceptional. This is a piece of bone from the Madagascar locality. It, in many regards, doesn't even look like a fossil. This is typical of the Madagascar material. It is not heavily stained. It's not been invested with iron, with manganese. It doesn't look like a typical fossil. If you didn't know, you might think you're picking up a cow bone today, a bleached cow bone.
I was looking at this thing thinking, this is really interesting.
It was the inside of the T-Rex bone that fascinated Schweitzer, who made thin sections out of it. And in these cross-sections of fossilized bone, she saw something that she and everyone else had thought was impossible. Round structures that looked like red blood cells. Dinosaur blood cells.
Inside those channels where the blood vessels would have run were these little round red structures that were all kind of lined up like a train, and they were bright red and translucent. Nobody else had seen anything like that before.
The very idea of blood cells in a 70 million year old bone was more than unconventional. It was radical.
Nobody was imagining that dinosaurs might have had preserved soft tissues.
Derek Briggs is curator of invertebrate paleontology at the Peabody Museum at Yale University.
So along comes Mary Schweitzer, and she's starting to look inside dinosaur bones and has made this startling discovery about the presence of red blood cells. What was your initial reaction to that?
Oh, I think the same reaction as everybody's, that this was totally improbable. She'd perhaps misinterpreted the evidence or was exaggerating the potential for what she was seeing.
So skeptical at first.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Why do you think it didn't occur to anybody?
Because we have this clear understanding that part of all biological cycles involves decay. I mean, nature is set up to break down that material and recycle it. So it's just improbable that those kinds of very delicate structures would survive, particularly for millions of years.
When you think about it, the laws of chemistry and biology and everything else that we know say that it should be gone. It should be degraded completely. This is not possible. Do it again. We got another piece of bone. We put it in the solution. We waited 2 or 3 or 4 weeks. Looked again, more blood vessels. We must have repeated that with probably 17 or 18 different fragments of bone.
Several ancient cultures have drawings and carvings of sauropod-like creatures. Look at this one from the Amazon rainforest that shows 9 warriors hunting what appears to be a sauropod dinosaur. It even dates to around the time the Book of Job was likely written.
You can see these amazing pictographs here, allegedly over 5,000 years old. They definitely look authentic. I've seen pictographs all over the world. And we have a hunting scene here with a very large animal in the center. Now we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 hunters. And you can see this hunter here is raising his spear, getting ready to spear this animal. Obviously, these people saw this animal alive. They didn't dig up the bones. They saw it living, breathing. They were hunting this animal. Well, what is it? Well, there's a lot of people that aren't sure what it is, but it sure looks like a dinosaur. It's got the long neck, the small head, the big body, and the large tail. Some have suggested maybe this is a camelid, like a llama. But llamas don't have big, large tails like that. Many reptiles do. But according to the theory of evolution, dinosaurs went extinct at least 65 million years ago. What in the world were people just over 5,000 years ago doing hunting them?
The local secular archaeologist would not tell us what he believed the animal was on film. Off camera, he admitted that it was a dinosaur that survived extinction and lived alongside people.
Why did so many different cultures draw and paint the same type of creature? As a land-dwelling creature that breathed through its nose, Noah was commanded to bring these types of creatures onto the ark, as juveniles, of course, and many likely survived for some centuries after the flood. When it comes to human history, to bridge the gap between 4 to 5,000 years ago and the distant past beyond this time, we each have two choices. Rely on God, who was there and told us what happened, or trust in carbon-14 dating and other types of radiometric dating beyond 100,000 years. Choosing between these two histories is no small matter. You see, people won't allow God's word to shape their daily lives or guide them in their eternal choices if they don't believe it's historically or scientifically credible. God's timeless word lays out Earth's initially perfect creation, the fall, the flood, and life afterwards. The New Testament describes Christ as the only way to be reconciled to God and live with Him in eternity. His timeless word gives us a clear testimony about when He created the world and the creatures that were present in the original creation, plus some of His magnificent creatures that survived after the flood. Why would God dedicate one of His longest animal descriptions to Behemoth, calling him the chief? Could it be to reassure Christians today that His word really is true, permanent, and dependable, and the viewpoint offered by the world is not? Are you a Christian student looking for answers about what the Bible teaches about creation, the fossil record, dinosaurs? Download the Genesis Apologetics app from the iTunes or Google Play stores for answers to these questions and
you can
more.
Stop that. Thank you. Pretty good, huh? So if you're watching online or you're in the sanctuary, in the description of the YouTube video will be a link to that video, and then you will be able to send it out to other people. Amen? Okay, so let's come back now, back into Job 40 and 41. So we're talking about Behemoth. Basically, that's what the video was all about. The next one is Leviathan, and he is, for our purposes, a dragon. Now, if I say that out loud, and 2000, what year is this? 22? Oh, Lord, help us. In 2022, people look at you like you're a kook. Oh, you're reading or you're seeing The Lord of the Rings or The Hobbit or something. And do you see what the world has done? They've made it a mystical story, right? Arthur and all of that. But yet, don't discount something just because it is lore or myth. And so I wrote down some questions to help us. A lot of these questions get asked of us. But they answered one of them for you in the video. How did Noah get those dinosaurs on the ark, right? And I hear this all the time. There wouldn't have been enough room. Yeah, they just need to be little juveniles. They don't need to be full-size dinosaurs. And so that obviously makes a whole lot of sense. Again, we need to lay aside hundreds of years of evolution teaching and just come back to the Bible and say what they're, and I love how the video does that at the end, doesn't it? If you believe in the Bible and you believe in what God said and he created this and you discount evolution, well, now you have to believe in a creator that has rules and has guidelines for your life, and people don't want to live that way, amen? They want to live how they want to live, so they came up with 65 million years ago dinosaurs were there. My favorite thing is the blood inside. You can't discount that. And yet, what does the guy do? He continues on and he says, don't believe your lying eyes. And we hear that today over and over. Here's facts, but don't look at those facts. And the facts point to a young earth, a young creation, exactly what the Bible says. Now, the other thing is, why is there dragons accounts in almost all cultures and people around the world? Why are they there? Is it just this myth that went around planet Earth? Or is it simply that they saw them and they lived amongst them? And it's better, Occam's razor says, the easiest solution... The easiest solution to the question is often the one that we should go with. A paraphrase, people are going to text in now and tell me I'm a bad scientist. But the idea is if plenty of cultures have drawings all over their, you know, caves and in manuscripts and in, from China to England to Africa, I mean, we could go into a whole thing how even up until the 1800s, where there were missionaries, remember these are Christians, that are, went around the world, tribes were telling people of Bohemoth down in the Congo. And this is all documented. And then you get into sailors on ships describing Leviathan in the sea. They're not just making this stuff up, because if it was one or two of them, you could understand. But there are volumes of sea captains who we trust if they were writing a log about something else or circumnavigating, but all of a sudden when he talks about some sea creature he sees, oh, he's just making it up. Well, you can't have it both ways, amen? If you believe that he went around the Horn of Africa and then he saw something on the other side in the Pacific, well, or the Atlantic, obviously that's going to be truthful. And so the Leviathan that we see here in chapter 41 is, for all intents and purposes, what we would know is some kind of dragon. I believe in Loch Ness Monster. Now, we haven't seen it in a long time. It may have died out, but it was some kind of sea creature. And it was interesting because if you go back to Noah and everything, and as the land is shifting around and moving, the lock could have been open to the sea, and those animals came in, and at some point it closed in, and now they were trapped in there. And there are huge caverns underneath Loch Ness, and so it is very possible that they could live in there for centuries, because no man is going to do what? He's going to kill them. They're so big. So sometimes it's just using logic and using the Bible. Again, God in 6 days created all things, even dinosaurs and dragons. And so why is that so hard to believe? Well, because we live in a modern world that says no, true science is 65 billion years old. And yet when true science gets hit with the actual reality of a young Earth, they have no response. Don't you love that? The guy's face is like, well, we don't know. I do. But if you say that to them now, you're a kook. Do you see, we've made mention of this. They have the ability to change the narrative on us so that the Christian almost fights a losing battle, even showing them blood cells and tissue that is elastic. And lastly, which is easy, animals go extinct. That's just what happens on planet Earth. And probably what happened is after the flood, the topography, the environment changed, and these animals, some of them lived a long time, like I said, even up into the 1800s, into the Congo, in areas where man really wasn't. And then there are areas where they just could not survive. They were better suited for the planet before Noah. Because of the humidity, because of the temperature. And Henry Morrison, which is a great creation scientist, has a theory that after the flood, there was an ice age, which we see, right? So we can see the evidence of an ice age. Well, if you have an ice age right after Noah, hundreds of years after, you're going to kill off a lot of dinosaurs who don't like ice. So it's not hard to go down the path of dinosaurs and dragons and man. All you have to do is take out man's science out of your head. Amen? And that, by the way, for me, that's real easy. It takes all of a second. Why? Because they believe in no God and that we are our own God. And so it's easy then to look at the Bible, look at the chapters, and go, wow, he's breathing fire. That's cool. In fact, some of the creationist guys now, when they've looked inside of the head of some of these animals, that there are pockets where they think they could have some form of gas or something that ignited that. Why is that hard to believe? Well, because we watch The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings, and we see it on the screen, and it looks fanciful, and we go, that could never happen. And yet it's all over the walls around the world that people have seen that, and the accounts of it. Why is it so hard? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and God said, I created these two amazing animals, Job. You know them. You've seen them. I mean, Job could have seen the flying Leviathan or in the sea, and God says, I have made them. Look at the end of it. He says, verse 34 of chapter 41, he says, he beholds every high thing. He is king over all the children of pride. So man either eventually wiped out all of these animals or the environment did, but it doesn't discount that God created them and that man lived with dinosaurs. Now listen, I'm a kook right now. Do you know that? And you're listening to me, and you're kooky now. You go tell your family members that man lived amongst the dinosaurs, they will think you're kooky. Not only that is, churches will think you're kooky. Isn't that frustrating? You're like, but it says it in the Bible. Oh, yeah, well, we believe everything in the Bible, just not those two chapters. Why? If Jesus could come out of a grave after being dead, what's the big deal with the dragon? I love the fact that there were dragons. How cool would that be to see that thing walking down the street? And the terror it put in. But and you might ask yourself, well, God, why did God do it? So man would know his purpose and his place, and that man is small. Do you see why God made dinosaurs? It shows us that we're this little thing, and this big thing just walked down the street. Amen? So read ahead, last chapter, woohoo! We're almost done with Job for next week. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for your word and for this day and for your servant Job. And we know, Lord, that you are the creator of all the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them. And that, Lord, that you created Behemoth and Leviathan for your purposes, Lord. And whatever that purpose was, we know that they were alive during the time of Job. And so, Lord, thank you for our time today. Thank you for your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand. Let's worship this last song. The men and women will be up in the front to pray with you. The Lord bless you. We'll be in Psalms on Wednesday night. Let's worship the Lord.